Once, a father sees his little son scratching on his car. He saw his son using a sharp object and scratching something on his car. He got really upset. He got really mad. This Vendaranda pulled his son, he twisted his son's hands very powerfully. It is said that the boy had developed multiple fractures. Moreover, the doctors had to amputate his tongue. The twist was so powerful that the boy lost his tongue. And it seems the boy asked his dad in the hospital, "Oh dad, when will this tongue grow?" Hearing this, he felt very sad. As dad came back home, he actually saw what his son had scratched on the car. Actually, his son had scratched, "I love you, dad." And dad he got devastated. He committed suicide. This story is quite popular in the Facebook. I don't know how true it is. Whatever it is, the story has got a very, very powerful message. This is what reaction can do to us. We end up doing what we don't want to do. Friends, we can have different approaches towards life. In today's discussion, let us just discuss about two approaches towards life. One is a reaction, the other is response. Actually, it might seem that a reaction is a kind of defense mechanism. A mechanism to defend our ego. A mechanism to defend our arrogance. A mechanism to defend our name or fame. Whenever we see whenever we perceive a threat to our ego, we end up reacting. The threat need not be a real threat. The threat need not be a real threat. It might be an imagined threat. Whenever I feel that somebody is encroaching into my comfort zone, I simply react. When I say this term reaction, it has got nothing to do with the reflex actions. All of us know what reflex actions are. I touch the fire, I remove my fingers instantly. I see a child suffering somewhere, I go and rescue the child. So this has got, reaction has got nothing to do with reflex actions. Reactions, they spring from a particular part of the brain. Whereas reflex actions, they spring up from a different part of the brain. So let us leave aside reflex actions today. This reaction, when we react emotionally to a particular situation, not only our physical body gets affected. First of all, our physical body gets affected, isn't it? Blood pressure shoots up, heartbeat rises. Reaction affects our physical body. Not only our physical body, our mind gets affected. Our mind gets clouded. When our mind gets clouded, we lose the ability to watch. We lose the ability to watch our words. We lose the ability to watch our actions as well. So what happens? When we don't watch our words, when we don't watch our actions, we end up speaking those words which we don't want to speak. We end up doing those actions which we don't intend to do. So reaction can really bring serious damage in our day-to-day interactions. However, response is something totally different. In any given circumstance, we need to mentally create a gap between ourselves and the situation. places in capital. In any given situation, in any given circumstance, we need to create a mental gap between ourselves and situation. When I use the term mental gap, I'm actually referring to time gap. And we use the time gap to watch the situation properly, to reflect upon properly, and to take decisions. After watching situation properly, after reflecting properly, after taking right decisions, those decisions get executed as actions. Those actions which are born out of decisions, those actions which are born out of reflection, we call it as response. When we learn to respond to different situations of life, slowly we discover a deep contentment and fulfillment within. So in today's lecture, let us try to discuss different means on how to uplift ourselves from the level of reaction to response, thereby discover deep contentment and peace in our life. Before going to the topic, let me recount an incident that happened many years back during one of our Indian tour. We were traveling from Ahmedabad to Jaipur. We were traveling from Ahmedabad to Jaipur. As many of you might know, usually number of buses accompany Amma during Indian tour. So Amma's car was far behind. Our buses were at the front. Suddenly all our buses came to halt. And we peeked out of the window and we found out that there was a traffic block. So we got out of the bus and we're just relaxing. Amma's car came there. So we expected Amma to join us there and have an informal chai break. But the opposite happened. Amma tried to find out the reason for the traffic block. And mother came to know that it was because of a tree. A massive tree had fallen on the national highway. And the traffic police were there and they were waiting for a JCB. They were waiting for a JCB to come there and remove that huge tree. And there was a reason for the traffic block, and for at least 2 or 3 kilometers, buses and cars were waiting on either side. As they expected Amma to join us and relax for some time, she did the opposite. She told us to bring the ropes from our buses. We brought the ropes from the buses. Mother approached the traffic police and got permission from them, and she told all of us to tie the ropes around the trees, and she wanted all of us to try and remove that huge log of tree. So within 10 minutes, that big log of tree which was lying on the middle of the national highway got removed. Mother told us to get into the buses and she started regulating the traffic. Within few minutes, the massive traffic block got cleared. Within few minutes, everything got settled, things came back to normalcy. Perfect example of response. Doing the right action at the right time. Born out of proper understanding, born out of proper reflection. If you are carefully listening, two questions might come up in your mind. Earlier you said reflection. What do you mean by reflection? Not sure how many of you got this question in your mind. For careful listening, this question should have come in your mind. Earlier you said, watch the situation properly, reflect. What do you mean by reflection? When I say reflection, I'm referring to two things. In any given situation, let us reflect upon our chosen goal. Chosen goal might differ from person to person. For you people, chosen goal might be to become a PhD, to take more PhDs, etc. My chosen goal is totally different. Chosen goal might differ from person to person. That doesn't matter at all. In any given situation, whenever you face a challenge, reflect upon your chosen goal. Remember your chosen goal. whatever I'm going to say, whatever I'm going to do, will it take me towards the goal or will it take me away from the goal? Think. If and only if this particular action is going to take you towards the goal, you need to do it. If that particular action is going to take you away from the goal, just avoid it. Am I clear? So what am I trying to say? In any given situation, whenever we face a challenge, let us remember our chosen goal. Let us remember our chosen goal and let us make a decision based upon it. Number two, let us remember the ethics, moral ethics. Our parents have taught us what is right, what is wrong. Society has taught us what is right, what is wrong. What is dharma, what is adharma. In any given situation, let us never ever go against the moral ethics that society and our family has taught us. The term reflection is referring to these two. Remembering the goal and remembering the moral ethics and deciding according to it. Another question might come up in your mind. Okay, you say that create a time gap. Maybe the time gap might last for a few minutes or a few seconds or a few hours. But in certain situations, it's not possible to create a time gap. In such situations, what should I do? This question might come up in your mind. Say for example, I'm driving a car. Suddenly a dog jumps in front of my car. There is no scope for creating a time gap. There is no scope for stopping and reflecting. There is no scope for pausing there. What should I do on such situations? If you are trained to respond on that particular situation, you will do what needs to be done. Got it? Somebody who merely reacts throughout his life will panic on such a situation. When a dog suddenly jumps in front of the car, he might panic. He might become hysterical. When you panic instead of pressing the brakes, you might end up pressing the accelerator. A person who basically reacts to given situations, he panics and he ends up doing a wrong action. Whereas a person who basically responds to a given situation, even when such sudden emergencies come, he does the right actions. So let us discuss a few suggestions on how to migrate from the level of reaction to response. This is possible only by practice. Arjuna asked Lord Krishna in Srimad Bhagavad Gita, "Oh Lord, my mind is so fickle. My mind is so weak. I don't have any mental strength. My mind just wanders here and there. What should I do?" Lord Krishna says, "Just don't worry, Arjuna. This is a universal problem. Abhyasena tu kaunteya. Only with practice can you gain control over your mind, Arjuna," says Lord Krishna. And let us discuss a few suggestions on how to migrate from the level of reaction to response. Suggestion number one. Let me call it as law of garbage truck. This happened many years back. As I was traveling, suddenly an auto rickshaw, he crossed my car. Usually in Chennai, the person who commits the mistake first, he will be the first to attack. Especially in traffic. The driver who commits the mistake first, he will be the first person to attack the other one, to be on safe side. That's a rule in Chennai. So this auto rickshaw driver, he was wrong. He overtook on the wrong side and he started hurling abuses on my driver. He started abusing my driver verbally. His entire family got abused. His father, grandfather, great-grandfather, entire lineage of his family got abused by the auto rickshaw driver. But my driver, he was very patient, he was very cool, very calm, composed. He merely smiled back and he said, "Have a good day." The auto rickshaw, they moved away. I was so understuck by his response. I asked him, "Hey, he was abusing your entire family, your entire lineage. And how could you say, have a good day?" Because then he taught his lesson to me, law of garbage truck. He said, sir, so many people in the society, they are like garbage trucks. All of us know about the metropolitan garbage trucks. Indian metropolitan, Indian garbage trucks. They're always full, isn't it? Garbage truck, as it goes around the town, soon it becomes full, but still they keep accumulating more and more. And what happens? As the truck moves, slowly the garbage starts overflowing from the truck. Sir, when you see garbage falling down from a garbage truck, you don't collect those garbage and put in your car. How wonderful was it? When you see garbage falling from a garbage truck, you don't end up collecting those garbage and putting in your car. Similarly, sir, so many people in society, they are like mobile garbage trucks. They're full of garbage of hatred, anger, jealousy, selfishness, etc. So naturally, such garbages, they come out. When they come out, let us not carefully collect them and accumulate. So I call this as love garbage truck. Brahma says, the person who gets angry, the person who shouts at you for no reason, actually the person has got some problem. There are many reasons why people shout at others. There are many reasons behind it. Maybe the person had a broken love affair. Maybe the person had a bad childhood. Maybe the person didn't receive enough love and care from his spouse. There might be many reasons why people get mad at you. I must say, such people, they deserve your compassion. They deserve your compassion. Anger is like a handicap. When you see a physically handicapped person, you don't feel angry at the person, you try to help that person. When you see a person on the wheelchair, you try your best to help that person on the wheelchair. Similarly, when somebody shouts at you, when somebody yells at you, the person deserves your help, not your anger. So let us get this right. Then we understand this lesson. Amma also gives another beautiful example. Amma says this ability to forgive others is there within each and every one of us. Each and every one of us have got the ability to forgive others. Amma gives the example of crow. See, we are neatly dressed. We plan to go to a party. We leave our house. Suddenly a crow eases on us. We don't get angry at the crow. We just go to a nearby tap and we clean our clothes. Similarly, when somebody shouts at you, when somebody yells at you, just feel that this person is easing on me. This person is just a crow or he's like a garbage truck. Just have that understanding and try to retain your inner cool. This is first suggestion that I'm giving. To migrate from the level of reaction to response. Suggestion number two. Let us place ourselves in others' shoes. Placing ourselves in others' shoes, that really helps us understand other person better. Had I been in his situation, or had I been in her situation, I might have behaved in a much worse way. When you place yourself in others' shoes, you really understand that the other person was not as bad as you think. When you place yourself in others' shoes, you gain the ability to understand the person. When you place yourself in others' shoes, you establish a connectivity with the other person. You establish a connectivity with the other person. Once, a guru asked his disciple, why do people shout loudly when they get angry? Isn't it? You don't whisper when you're angry. Right? You shout loudly. Then you become angry. Guru asked his disciple, why is that? Why is that people shout when they get angry? The disciple didn't have any answer. And the Guru asked, why do lovers whisper? Lovers don't talk loud. Why do lovers whisper? And why do angry people shout at each other? The disciple didn't have any answer. After some time, the Guru said, one person shouts at the other person under the influence of anger because though he is physically near that person, mentally a big gap has been created. Mentally a huge gap has been created. Just to cover that huge distance, the person shouts. And the opposite, two lovers. so much of closeness between them. Two bodies are one heart. So there is no need to shout. There is no need to shout. Because there is this oneness between two hearts. That's why lovers, they don't shout. At times they don't even whisper, they merely to gaze at each other's. There is no need of words between them. The same is true. Whenever this mental gap gets created, the connectivity gets lost. Whenever mental gap gets widened, you lose the ability to understand the other person better. So this suggestion, placing yourself in other's shoes, it helps you re-establish the connectivity with the person. It narrows the gap. It narrows the mental gap with the other person. When we don't try to understand the other person, when we don't try to place ourselves in other's shoes, what happens? We end up superimposing our own mistakes and limitations on the other person. Got it? When we don't place ourselves in other's shoes, we end up superimposing our own mistakes and limitations on the other person. Once a husband thought that his wife has got some serious hearing problem, right? He thought that his wife is losing her ability to hear properly. So he visits the doctor. The doctor gives him a manual, an operating manual. He said, read this manual and go and test in your house. He reads the manual. The manual says, try calling out the person from 40 feet away. The person doesn't respond. Try calling out the person from 30 feet away. Even if that doesn't respond, try calling the person from 20 feet away. Even if that doesn't respond, try calling the person from 10 feet away. So he thought, okay, let me try on my wife and let me try to know that how bad is her hearing. He goes home. He stands 40 feet away from kitchen and he calls out, oh darling, what have you made for today's dinner? No response. He moves further. He thought, oh, for you, my wife can't hear 40 feet. That's bad. He goes 30 feet closer to his wife and he asks her, he calls out, oh honey, what have you made for dinner? Again, no response. Again, he goes 20 feet here. Now he calls out, oh baby, what have you made for today's dinner? Again, no response. Now he goes even further closer and he repeats the same question, oh my dear, what have you made for the dinner? She starts yelling at him. How many times have I told you that I made chapatis for tonight? How many times have I told you that I made chapatis for tonight? So what? Actually, he had a hearing problem and he thought his wife has got it. This is what happens when you don't place yourself in other's shoes. This is what happens when you don't develop connectivity with others. This is what happens when you don't bridge mental gap with others. You end up superimposing your own weaknesses and limitations on others. Suggestion number 3. So far we discussed 2 suggestions. Now let us discuss suggestion number 3. I'm going to say this. We need to slowly understand that our true nature is different from the role that we are playing. A role of a student, a role of a teacher, whatever that you're doing, it's mere role. Husband, wife, it's mere role. The role is different from your true nature. See the role as a role. Ability to see a role as a role is most needed. I often give this example. The teacher who is strict in the school should leave aside all the strictness in the school itself. And the teacher goes back home, she needs to become a loving mother. So ability to see the role as a role. When we are at the office and when we have at least 10 or 20 people working under us, at times we need to be strict with them. At times we need to be strict with them. But let us use the strictness as a mask. Let us use the strictness as a mask. Let us use the anger as a mask. What do I mean by that? A ability to see, ability to separate action from the person. Got it? Ability to separate the action from a person. It is true that I can find fault with the action of my staff. My staff is lazy, my staff doesn't work properly. So I'm angry towards a particular action of laziness. Even laziness is an action. I am angry towards, I'm unhappy towards a particular action of my staff. I'm not angry at my staff. Ability to separate a person from the action. You can't find fault with the action. You cannot find fault with the person. The person is potentially divine. Every soul is potentially divine. Every mistake that you perceive in others, listen carefully. Every mistake that you perceive in others, every defect that you see in others, merely dwells in the grosser personality of the person. The core of the person is free from all mistakes that you see. The core of the person is totally pure. So let us have this understanding. The person is different from the action. The same is true with ourselves as well. Ability to see the role as a role. Ability to use the role as a mask. So when you play the role properly. Play the role to the best of your ability. But no sooner that particular role, no sooner that, when Amma compares it to a drama. The drama artist, he plays the role to the perfection. At times, the same artist might have to play multiple roles in the same drama. The first scene, he might be a minister. The second scene, the same person might change the makeup and he might appear as somebody else. But whatever it is, the person plays the role perfectly. And no sooner the scene is over, there is no hangover of the role in the person. Right? Oh, in the previous scene I was a minister, so let me repeat the same dialogues in the next scene. No, that doesn't happen. There is no hangover. That role is finished. That scene is finished. The person totally detaches himself or herself from that role. And the person gets ready for the next role. Each and every one of us. Let us have this understanding. The role that I'm playing is different from my true nature. And the action that people perform, that's different from their true nature. And let us do what needs to be done in a given situation. Let us not carry any load of hatred. So when we try to do this, when we develop this ability to separate the person from the action, we won't carry the load of hatred. We won't carry the load of anger against anybody. As such, anger is not bad. As such, anger is not bad. But carrying the load of anger within, that is really bad. A mother, at times mother expresses anger towards her child, but mother never carries the load of anger in her heart. Whatever anger that a mother expresses towards her child is for the goodness of the child. Mother is full of love with it. Though mother shouts at her child, though mother chastises her child, she is full of love. We can develop the same attitude towards our staff. We can develop the same attitude towards the fellow beings around. And not carry the load of anger, not carry the load of hatred with it. So when we fail to see a role as a role, when we fail to see a role as a role, what happens? We get too attached to the roles that we play. When we get too attached to the roles that we're playing, what happens? We fail to acknowledge the freedom of others. We fail to acknowledge the feelings of others. We start poking our nose. We start encroaching into others' freedom. We end up becoming human repellents. Just as they are mosquito repellents, such people who are madly attached to the role that are playing, they become like human repellents. People just ran away from them. I remember a devotee from Trivandrum. He wanted his little daughter to become a dancer. That was very little, just 4 or 5 years old. And he started imposing all his desires on her. Oh daughter, you need to become a dancer. You need to become a dancer. he became too strict with her. He started encroaching into her freedom. A five-year-old girl, of course she wants to have ice cream with her friends. He would never allow her. No ice cream. You shouldn't take ice creams. You'll become fat. No chocolates. Come on, what life is it without chocolates and ice cream? The child is not worth living without chocolates and ice cream. This father, he denied his daughter all chocolates and ice creams. No movies. He was very strict with his daughter. Of course, she learned dancing. She mastered dancing. After she grew up, she told her father very clearly, "I shall never ever dance in my life." So because of his strictness, because of his encroachment into her freedom, she ended up developing hatred towards dancing. Now the devotee, he really feels bad. I shouldn't have been that strict with her. I shouldn't have encroached into her freedom. Though my intentions were good, the way I executed it was not proper. This shouldn't happen to us. This shouldn't happen to us. This will happen if you fail to see the role as a role. So, suggestion number 3, see the role as a role. Give your best. Be detached with them. Acknowledge others' freedom. Acknowledge others' feelings and emotions. This is suggestion number 3. Suggestion number 4, change the perspective of life. You can basically be a positive person or a negative person. There is no third possibility, isn't it? Say a person enters into this world. A person, let us imagine that somebody is entering into the hall, say our Ganesh Rupaji, right? Ganesh Rupaji enters into the hall and he sees the hall, he sees people seated here. If our Udupasar is basically a negative person, what will be his comment? Come on, they organize a lecture, see, hardly 50 people are there. What sort of organization is this? Nonsense. That might be his comment. On the opposite, if our Udupaji is a positive person, he might say, wow, so many people, so many results scholars are here. Wow. So many people are available for a spiritual lecture. That's great. Same situation. Two totally different comments, isn't it? When you make a negative comment, when you have a negative approach towards life, you merely focus on the limitations. Got it? When you are a positive person, instead of focusing on the limitations, instead of focusing on the mistakes, you start focusing on the brighter side. Friends, life is always combination of good and bad. Life is always combination of brightness and darkness. There cannot be absolute brightness. There cannot be absolute darkness. There cannot be absolute good. There cannot be absolute bad. All depends on what you are going to focus on. All depends on what you prefer to focus on. Do you agree with me? Do you agree with me? I don't feel, see any response. Glad. Let me repeat once more. Life is always combination of good and bad. People around us, they're always combination of good and bad. You cannot come across somebody who is totally good. You cannot come across somebody who is totally bad. Life is always combination of good and bad. People around us are always combination of good and bad. All depends on what we are going to focus on. Amma says beautifully, even a broken watch shows right time twice a day. What a perspective. What an approach towards life. Even a broken watch shows right time twice a day. And mother says, there is nobody whom you can label as useless. There is nothing that is insignificant in life, says Amma. I remember many years ago, when Amma was giving darshan in Amrita Puri, a father brought his daughter, young daughter, to Amma. And he said, oh Amma, my daughter is depressed. She's really sad. And Amma asked, what's the reason? And father said, Amma, she missed her medical seat by just few marks. She missed her medical seat by a whisker. Now she has nearly got admission to an engineering college and she is totally unhappy about it. She is very sad. I really wanted to see what Amma is going to tell her. You know what Amma said? Amma asked her, my daughter, do you know who will prefer a medical profession? Only those who are willing to deal with sick people will choose medical profession. Only those who are willing to constantly deal with sick people will choose medical profession, my daughter. My daughter, life offers infinite possibilities. When there are chances, when there are possibilities to deal with healthy people, why do you want to deal with sick people, my daughter? Even if somebody offers you a medical seat for free, don't choose it. Those words from mother, it brought tremendous transformation in her. If I am going to say those words to her, she might feel like beating me. Isn't it? But the question is, why does mother's words create a deep impact in somebody? What's the reason? Because there is no gap between thoughts, words and deeds. Absolute integrity. Absolute integrity between words and deeds. It is that perfect integrity in mother. It is a purity in mother that gives tremendous power to words. How does we think something, we say something else, we end up doing something totally different. We end up doing totally different. We don't have any integrity. It's because of lack of integrity that our words don't have that much power. So what I was trying to say, mother's words, mother's suggestion to her, it brought total transformation in her perspective and she became happy once again. So having a positive attitude towards life, having a positive approach towards life, focusing on the brighter side of life, focusing on the brighter side of the people around us, that will really help us to migrate from the level of reaction to response. Once Shri Buddha was giving lectures to his disciples. At that point, a non-believer entered into the place and he spat on Shri Buddha's face. Just imagine, Guru is here addressing his disciples. At the end of the lecture, somebody enters in, a non-believer enters in and he spits on Guru's face. And Shri Buddha merely wiped it and he asked him, do you have anything more to say? The person didn't expect Shri Buddha to say that. The person just went back. After he went back, he couldn't sleep peacefully. He kept on thinking about it again and again. Hey, went there, I spat on his face. He never got angry with me. He merely asked me, do you have anything more to say? That person is really a great person. I was foolish to be so rude to him. That night he couldn't sleep properly. He kept on thinking again and again. Next morning he rushed towards Shri Buddha. He fell on Shri Buddha's feet and he kept on seeking pardon. Oh Lord, please forgive me. Please forgive me for spitting on your face. Shri Buddha asked him, who are you? He said, well, this is the same person who spat on your face yesterday. And Shri Buddha said, no, this is not the same person. This is not the same person. This person is totally different from the one who spat yesterday. The one who spat yesterday was full of anger. The one who is now there in front of me is full of remorse. This person is different to other person. It's totally different. So who needs to forgive whom? And he said, just as you don't step on the same river twice, you don't see the same person twice. You don't see the same person twice. The moods keeps changing constantly. Emotions keep changing constantly. Let me simply remember this fact. I don't see the same person again. You don't carry any load of hatred with him. We carry a load of hatred because we think that the same person is there in front of us. No. Just as you don't see the same river twice, you don't see the same person twice. Let us have this understanding, let us develop a positive perspective towards life, and that will help us migrate slowly from the level of reaction to response. Last but not the least, compassion born out of understanding. Compassion born out of understanding will help us to migrate to the level of reaction to response. When I say this, I remember tsunami. When tsunami waves struck the coast of Kerala, Amrutapuri Ashram was badly affected. The serious material losses. Of course, by grace, there was no loss of life. The serious material losses. So I was moving things. I was working in an incense department those days. So I was moving all the incense sticks to safety. Because it was too late. I was trying to move things. Suddenly, I developed a desire to see what Amma is doing. So I went to see what Amma is doing. I saw Amma standing on the waters, Amma giving instructions to people on what to do, etc. When Amma saw a couple of brahmacharis around her, Amma told us, go to the nearby houses and save old people and infants. Because there are chances that infants are still, the children, there are chances that babies and there are chances of old people are stuck inside the houses. Go to the nearby houses and save them. Because I didn't like it. Because the people around those days, they were really anti-Amma. So I thought, why should we go and save them? Amma said, go. It was a firm instruction from Amma. So I just went around. The house, which is, it was right next to the ashram. I think right now the girls are still standing there. Somewhere there. Somewhere nearby our girls' hostel, Amrutapuri Ashram. There, we saw an old man, maybe around 80 or 85 years, who was stuck inside the house. Of course, everybody in the family had escaped. Right? His son, daughter, I mean his son, daughter-in-law, everybody had escaped. This old man, nobody saved this old man. This old man was stuck inside, was crying. So we went there and we saved the old man and we brought him to the ashram. No sooner this old man was brought to the ashram, his daughter-in-law was inside the Kali temple, Kali hall. She came down running to Amma and she started shouting at Amma. We left him back purposefully. We left him behind purposefully, and your children, your stupid children, they went and brought him back. I was shocked when I heard this. Even mother was shocked when she heard this. Daughter, why do you say that? And she said, he's good for nothing. Had he died in tsunami, we might have got some money from the government. Government might have paid us a 1 lakh or 2 lakhs for relief. Now that your stupid brahmachari saved them, we are deprived of the government fund. We are deprived of the government help. And what are we going to do with this old man? Amma said, daughter, please don't say that. Please never say that. Don't worry, Amma shall build a house for you. You said you might get 1 lakh or 2 lakhs if he dies, isn't it? Amma shall build you a nice house which is much more worthier than that. Amma consoled that lady. After that, Amma turned towards her and said, this is the nature of the world. This is the nature of the world. And don't feel any hatred towards that lady. This is the nature. You cannot blame her. This is the nature of the world. After that, construction of tsunami houses started. Entire ashram moved here to the biotech building. Entire ashram moved here. I mean, engineering college. I don't think it was ready those days. Was it ready? No. It was not ready, right? One floor was ready. So, entire ashram got moved here. People are camping here. Tsunami day. It was on tsunami day. Entire ashram got moved here. People are camping here. And we started making food. We started cooking food for people here. Then Amma wanted us to take the food from here and just visit all the tsunami affected places and give food. The Arikil village, right? The beach village. So, it was the next morning. So that particular day, we couldn't feed the villagers. It was not practically possible. So next day of tsunami, we made breakfast for them and we took to the village and really wanted to serve the breakfast to them. We got a very, very angry reaction from the villagers. They started shouting at us, where were you yesterday? Where were you yesterday? Hey, it's not our job to feed them, right? It's government's job. When a Disaster strikes a place, it's a job of the government to feed the people. But the government never existed in those days. Not a single minister visited this place. Not a single minister from the government of Kerala. I don't know which government. I think it was Congress government. Not a single minister came here. Not a single opposition leader came here. Nobody from the government came here. And these people, they should have genuinely shouted at the government and the political leaders whom they voted for. And they ended up shouting at us, "Where were you yesterday?" We got so upset. Come on, we came here to feed you people and you're so arrogant. And we didn't give food to them. We came back. Amma got upset with us. See, this is what understanding can do. Amma said, it's true that they shouted at you. It is true that they were rude at you. But you need to understand the situation. See, these are the people who lost everything in tsunami. They lost their children, they lost their property, and they lost everything they had, and they don't have any savings. Totally affected by a disaster, and they shout because of that. So why do they feel bad? It's understanding, right? You understand them. The reason for the shouting, the reason for the rude behavior is because of loss of property, loss of our lives. You understand that. Go back to them, say sorry, and feed them. So we went back. And we said sorry and we gave food to them. After that, the attitude of the villagers started changing towards us. Total shift in their attitude. They could really see that we were helping for no reason, without any expectation. They could really see that mother's help was unconditional. That brought in total transformation in their life. So what I'm trying to say, compassion born out of understanding. Compassion born out of understanding helps us migrate from the level of reaction to response. Let me share a true incident and when did it start? 10:10. Hello, we're talking, keep on talking. What?
40 minutes ago.
40 minutes ago, okay. It's a problem, I keep on talking. So, what was I saying? Yeah, compassion born out of understanding. Compassion born out of understanding can really help us migrate from the level of reaction to response. Let me give another suggestion. Let us drop the notion that only I am right. The notion that only I am right is a strong indication of ego. Only a highly egoistic person will feel, only I am right. Whatever I do is right. Whatever I say is right. Whatever I think is right. Only a strongly egoistic person will feel like that. If you're going to feel that way, only I am right, you turn blind to others. You turn blind to suggestions of others. You turn blind to the abilities and skills of those who are around you. When you turn blind to others' abilities, when you turn blind to others' suggestions, you merely end up reinforcing your ego. You merely end up reinforcing ego. As your ego gets reinforced, you end up finding fault with everybody around. It's a very, very bad habit of finding fault with everybody around. Fault finding nature. And opposite, if you're a positive person, though you see a mistake in somebody, you will try to help the person. That's a big difference between these two. Please get it right. If you're a negative person, and if you merely keep reinforcing your ego, you merely find fault with others, you merely criticize others, you never help the person. And the opposite, if you are a positive person, if you are the one who responds to given situations, of course you find fault with others, but instead of criticizing the person, you try to help that person. It's a big difference. It's fault-finding nature. When I say this, I remember a story. Once, a man, he had a startup. He called it as a 5-star. Right? A 5-star, he had named it as 5-star. And he was not doing well in his business. So he didn't know what to do. Of course, he had all the best facilities available. Best services available. Somehow he was not doing well in his business. So he approached a spiritual master and he sought the guidance of the spiritual master. The master said, better change the name of your restaurant. You call it as Six Bells. You call it as Six Bells and you hang five bells outside your restaurant. Got it? You change the name into Six Bells and merely hang five bells outside your restaurant. And the businessman didn't know why the guru said. The guru merely said, just do it. And accordingly, he changed the name of his restaurant from Five Star to Six Bells. And according to Guru's instructions, he hung five bells outside his restaurant. So what happened? The first person who passed, he read the name. It says, what does it say? Six bells. And how many bells did he see outside? Five bells. And he thought, hey, there's something wrong here. And I'm the first person to see it. So he went inside and he saw the owner and he said, there's a serious mistake. You call your restaurant as Six Bells and I see only five bells outside. And the manager said, okay, thank you. And he offered a cup of chai. And he was happy with chai and he decided to take breakfast there. And this started repeating again and again. Every person who passed by, he would notice a sign which said, Six bells, and he merely sees five bells. He enters into five to point out the mistake and he ends up taking food there, and thus the sales increased. It's a funny story. The story really indicates that each and every one of us got this tendency to find fault with others. And when we find fault with others, we have the secret belief, I am the first person to find it. I am the first person to see it. I am the first person to acknowledge it. Which is a totally wrong notion. So, I was just discussing a few suggestions today on how to migrate from the level of reaction to response. As we migrate from the level of reaction to response, we become a blessing to the world and others. Our life becomes a blessing to society. Our life becomes a blessing to the family. We gain the ability to accept others as they are. We gain the ability to accept others as they are. Let me just share one of my experience and conclude this discussion. This happened a couple of years back. One day Amma was giving darshan in Amrita ashram and Amma called me. So I went here, Amma. Amma introduced me to a person. Amma embraced the person. Amma made the person sit next to her and Amma wanted me to interact with that person. I started interacting with the person and I understood that. Actually, he was a criminal. He was a convict who was undergoing life imprisonment, 12 years of imprisonment for killing somebody. Actually, he had come out on parole. He had come out on parole because his wife had died in Thrissur. He wanted to attend his wife's cremation, so he had come out. Pujapura prison, Trivandrum. So from Pujapura prison, Trivandrum, he got government's permission, he came on parole to attend his wife's cremation in Thrissur. He went for his wife's cremation. His sons, they didn't want him to attend the cremation. They said, because of you, we suffered so much in our life. The society labeled us as son of a criminal. Mother and we, both of us, we suffered a lot because of your crime. We don't want you to attend mother's cremation. We are no more your son, you are no more our father. To that he felt so bad. So before going back to Pujapura prison, after taking permission from the police, he came to Amma for darshan. That was how we got introduced. Amma assured him, my son, don't worry. Amma is there for you. Even if the society rejects you, even if your children reject you, Amma won't reject you. Amma is there for you. This was a guarantee that Amma gave him. And he went back. I forgot the whole thing. And Onam season was approaching. As all of you know, all television channels, they make special programs for Onam. So it was Onam season. So I need to go to Amrita TV Trivandrum. It was a Saturday. So I go to Amma. I seek Amma's permission to go to Trivandrum. Suddenly Amma pulled my pen. Usually I have a pen in my shirt. Amma pulled my pen and she grabbed a packet of prasad from near her and she wrote on it, Moon Umma, kisses to my son. And she gave the prasad to me and she said, give this prasad to Jail Moon. For Amma, everybody is Moon or Mold. even a cat or a dog or an elephant, everybody is a mon or a mole. When Amma said, give this prasad to jail mon, I really didn't understand whom Amma was referring to. He said, Amma, whom? Amma said, the one whom I, whom you got introduced to a month back, or 2 months back. He said, Amma, he is somebody who is undergoing a lifetime imprisonment in Pujapura prison. It is not easy to meet a criminal in the prison. You need government's permission, right? You cannot just go to prison somebody straight away and just see, just meet a person like that. You need permission, and I have not applied for permission, and I don't even know the name of the person. How can I go to Pujapura prison, and how am I going to meet him? Amma said, just obey my words. So I was sure that it's going to happen, but I didn't know how it's going to happen. I went to Trivandrum that day, and as I said earlier, it was Onam season. Amrita TV was preparing many special shows for Onam, and that particular day, that particular Saturday, they had planned a feast in Pujapura prison. Onam Sadhya in Pujapura prison with, what's his name, Swaraj. Actor Swaraj, he was supposed to accompany Amrita TV team, and they were supposed to give him the prisoner's feast. So I thought, maybe this is the best chance. What's his name, Swaraj or Suraj? Yeah, whatever. So I thought, okay, let me accompany the team, and there's the best chance of seeing. So I went with him, I went with Amrita TV team to Pujapura prison. Cool. Only after going to Pujapura prison, I understand that it's a mini township. So many prisoners, hundreds and hundreds of people living there. How am I going to meet this person whose name I don't even know? The feast was given, I couldn't see him. After this comedian, he starts performing. He goes to stage and he starts performing. At the end of his performance, he asks the people, can somebody imitate me? And this particular person whom I was searching for, this karmic whom I was searching for, he stands up. And he starts imitating Suraj beautifully. So I've seen him now. So I need to approach him and give Amma's prasad. What should I do? So I go to the police people who are in charge of the prison and express my desire. They were saying, no, it's not possible. Then they say, okay, we shall give you permission, but provided you need to shoot us and show us on TV. Fine, okay, that's possible. So we shoot the top police people there. And I get a permission to talk. Okay, we just give you 5 minutes to talk with him. Okay, I get 5 minutes with that criminal. I go to him. And I tell him, I'm coming from Amma. Amma has given you her prasad. This is here is Amma's prasad for you. He gets it. He sees Mon Umma. And he starts crying profusely. He starts crying uncontrollably. I couldn't control him. I asked him, what happened? He said, well, actually, I was planning to commit another murder because I thought, hey, what am I going to do? My children, they've rejected me. I don't have a wife now. The society is going to reject me for sure. So that I cannot go back to the world. I cannot work in the world. And Amma, of course, Amma said, Amma will take care of you. Even if the society rejects you, even if the family rejects you, Amma will take care of you. But Amma is busy. She might have said those words just to console me. Amma is busy. She might not even remember me. And I'm a criminal. She's got so many good-hearted people, but I'm just a criminal. Amma might not even remember me. So I had those strong feelings last night, and I thought, okay, let me commit another murder in this prison. That way, I might either get hanged, or I might get one more life in prison. I can simply stay in this prison. That was a plan that I had last night. And now, Amma sends her prasad. So, and it says, Mon Umma. It clearly says that Amma really means what she said. I really understand now that really Amma cares me. I now really understand that Amma's words and actions are just one. There's no difference between her words and actions. I can really feel her love. I can really feel that even if the entire society rejects me, even if the entire world around rejects me, even if my own children have rejected me, I have Amma who loves me unconditionally. Well, this is a peak of response. Ability to accept everybody around unconditionally. Ability to receive the entire world around unconditionally. That's a peak of response. It's possible for each and every one of us here to get uplifted to that level of unconditional acceptance. I just merely gave a few suggestions today. There are many, many more suggestions to uplift ourselves to the level of response. So if you have any questions, you can ask. Whatever answer I know, I'll be trying to give. Please feel free to propose this. I'm sure you have questions. Yes, sir.
I kick start it.
Pardon?
I can kick start it.
Yeah. Please ask an easy question. Please ask an easy question so that I know the answer for the question.
It's a simple question.
Yeah, please, sir.
You talked about changing the perspective of life. Could you indicate which kind of perspectives that you would be appropriate?
Yeah, I thought I was saying about that. I was saying that we can either be positive or negative. We can either Lord Krishna clearly says in Gita, guna guneshu vartante. Everybody around us, every object around us, they are under constant modification. Constant modifications, they keep taking place. Sattva guna, rajo guna, tamo guna, they keep modifying constantly. So as these gunas keep modifying constantly, a person behaves in a rude way or in a good way. When sattva guna is predominant in the person might be very gentle. The person might behave in a very, very decent way. If rajoguna is predominant, if rajoguna or tamoguna becomes predominant in the person might behave rude. So in the same person, these two behaviors, gentle behavior and rude behavior, they exist. But on what are you going to focus on? Are you going to merely give importance to the rude behavior of the person, or are you going to focus your attention on the positive side of the person? That's what I was referring to. The perspective, right? Perspective indicates focusing on the strength of a person. Of course, you acknowledge the person as he is or as she is. The person has got weaknesses, but along with those weaknesses, the person has got strength as. Let me not merely focus on the weaknesses. Let me focus on the strength of the person. That's what I was referring to. That's intended meaning of the term perspective. In this watch, it's got two sides. When I see one side of the watch, I need to know that the watch has got the other side as well. The other side of the watch might be better than the side that I'm seeing. Got it? Similarly, that each and everybody has got other side, which you don't see, which you don't know. The other side of the person might be much, much better than the side that you are seeing, the side that you are facing. Acknowledge this fact. Remember this fact. And you remember this fact, you won't carry a load of hatred against anybody. It's we who get benefited, not the other person. It's we who get benefited first. This is what I was intending by being changing the perspective. Let us decide on what I am going to focus on. Yes? No more questions? Yes, ma'am.
Are people driven by strong likes and dislikes when they react? And sometimes people say, probably youngster, that they want to let out the steam, they can't hold it. How do we try to change that?
This is a new trend, right? Letting out. Actually, letting out is never a solution. We don't mean to say suppress. Suppression leads to explosion. And letting out is never a solution. Scriptures say, by merely letting out your emotions, you are merely strengthening those emotions. Hope I am clear. By merely letting out emotions, those emotions don't get weakened. Those emotions actually they get strengthened. How to understand this? Listen carefully. Actions repeated becomes our habit. Habit repeated becomes our character. It is our character that forms the core of our personality. Okay, letting out an emotion called anger. If I keep on letting the emotion called anger again and again, I am merely forming thought patterns, similar thought patterns. Those similar thought patterns of letting out anger, they end up merely what? Strengthening that weakness called anger within me. So letting out is not a solution at all. Letting out a particular emotion and trying to overcome the emotion is like pouring ghee on the fire and trying to quench the fire. That's not never going to happen. You agree with me? You can never put out fire by pouring ghee on it. So instead of letting out an emotion, die diverting the motion. Diversion is what is suggested in our scriptures. Divert a particular emotion. If you are going to divert the particular emotion towards God, if you are going to divert the particular emotion towards a guru, that particular emotion will slowly will lose the negative aspects in it. This is what our scriptures say. This is what our rishis who performed research in their inner laboratories, they exclaim. Letting out an emotion is not a solution. Instead, intelligently divert the emotion towards God. Anger. Instead of shouting at your staff, go to a private room, shout at Allah. Shout at God. If it's Krishna, if it's Jesus, whoever is your chosen deity, shout at God. Oh God, why did you put me in this situation? You're so bad, you're so cruel, whatever you want to say. Empty, no problem. Because what are you doing? Listen carefully. God is embodiment of infinite compassion. God is embodiment of infinite love. So you are pouring your emotions towards infinite love. You are pouring, you are unburdening your emotion towards infinite compassion. Then what happens? Your emotion is, it's a finite emotion, isn't it? Whether it is anger or hatred, whatever emotion that comes out from you is a finite emotion. And you are trying to pour it in front of somebody who is infinite. So what happens? This finite emotion, it gets weaker. And those divine qualities of the infinite, it slowly comes to you. So letting out an emotion is not a solution. Instead, intelligently diverting those emotions towards God, towards Guru, that is a real solution. That will really help us get uplifted. It's a deep topic. Just gave a brief answer. Yes? Anything more? Yes? Yes, please.
Sir, so, I'm basically from a biology background.
Yeah, sure.
Since influenced by Darwinistic powers also.
Yeah.
So, Darwinistic principle says that any action, any modification, it can be at the level of consciousness or whatever it is, it derives some benefits. So even people have argued against that altruistic, being altruistic or being totally unconditional also gives certain benefits, who is proposing that or who is thinking about it. So if that is the case, what kind of benefit do we get from being unconditional? Or not in terms of benefits, or what is that particular source? Or what is that particular kind of a stronghold that we have to be unconditional, to become unconditional or selfless service or whatever it is? Do we derive any benefits from that, or no benefit at all is required?
Okay. I think I understand you, sir. Being unconditional, being selfless, except from a limited sense, right? Absolute unconditional love or absolute unconditional behavior, absolute selfless behavior is possible only for somebody is totally detached from body, mind and intellect, right? Somebody is totally free from all negativities and when we call them as liberated beings. Only in the case of somebody like Amma, only in case of liberated soul, absolute unconditional love or absolute unconditional behavior, selfless behavior is possible. As far as being limited beings are concerned, from our level, we are trying for that. We are trying, we know, we see that. I mean, this is our goal. To expand our mind is our goal. And we are trying to help others selflessly. Scriptures say, as we try to practice a bit of selflessness, as she asked, slowly the likes and dislikes will drop. That's what happens. Slowly the likes and dislikes drop. Slowly you go beyond attraction and aversion. That's the needed benefit. It is this likes and dislikes that cause divisions. We divide society. We divide the people around into a number of parts. Those who are supportive over ego. And those who don't support. And those who support over ego, we call them as friends. Right? And those who don't support our ego, We label them as enemies. So we divide, this tendency to divide into two. This division is the cause of all problems. The division, the unintelligent division that we mentally create, that's the cause of all our problems. And here, when we try to practice selflessness in whichever way possible, whichever way, little way possible, slowly, slowly, this bad habit of dividing, this bad habit of developing attraction, aversion, slowly drops. We become much more united. Integrity, I was talking about the integrity, right? The integrity between our thoughts, words and actions. Slowly we gain more and more integrity. And that's what gets expressed as peace within. So just, and as an answer to your question, peace, inner peace is the answer. A simple test to find out whether you're on the right track or not. Okay, I'm trying to do some charity, I'm trying to do some selfless seva. Am I doing it right? The answer is, how peaceful are you? I say peace is immediate benefit. And I was earlier explaining the mechanism how you get the peace. In the divisions, slowly they narrow down. You discover more peace. And the peace gets expressed through your words and deeds. More peaceful you are, more peace you radiate. People who come in contact with you, they feel more peace. Every words that you utter, every action that you do, they reflect peace and love. That's indication that you are peaceful with them. And that peace you discover by trying to practice selflessness or unconditionals. I'm not sure if I really are you convinced? At least a bit. It's possible only to answer a bit of questions actually. Slowly it's from within you get that answers, full answers. It was a deep topic, I just merely touched the tip of it. Okay, shall we conclude? Hope the discussion was beneficial. It was beneficial for me. Help me reflect.